Matlock will not be seen tonight so that we may bring you this KRON-TV special presentation, Stanford, A Sentimental Journey.
Indonesia is about as far from Stanford University as you can get. It's hot. It's wet. It's one of the most densely populated countries on Earth. But travel 24 hours by plane and take a 5-hour drive into a volcanic mountain range, and there you will find Russ Diltz, Stanford class of 74. Chances are you've never heard of Russ Diltz up to now. We'll be telling you more about him later. But you probably have heard of these other Stanford grads. Sandra Day O'Connor, class of 1950, Supreme Court Justice. Bill Hewlett, class of 34, one of the founders of Silicon Valley. Jim Plunkett, class of 70, football's comeback king. Ken Kesey, class of 59, author and outlaw. Sally Ride, class of 73, first American woman in space. There was a time when all these folks, famous and not so famous, were college kids like any others. They stayed up too late, they argued with their parents, they tested themselves and everyone else around them. And it all happened for them right here in the Bay Area, right here at Stanford University.
A 100 years ago, there was nothing here but oak trees and meadows. Today, this place is filled with students and scholars, thousands of them. When you think of other great schools, like Harvard, which just celebrated its 350th birthday, you realize that Stanford really is the new kid on the block. This cornerstone was laid in 1887. That's 5 years before the first class graduated from here. All 37 of them. Today, this stone is surrounded by 10 million square feet of sandstone. This spring, more than 4,000 students will graduate from here. In just 100 short years, this place has become a source of pride for all of us in the Bay Area. Tonight, we celebrate Stanford's first century as some of its most illustrious students and faculty take a look back at the accomplishments and the people that have made it great.
Stanford University is a place where miracles happen, and this is one of them. It's just after midnight, and the folks at Stanford Medical Center are about to save a life. A 24-year-old mother of two is waiting for a new heart, and by dawn, she'll have one. She's in good hands. The doctors here have been doing heart transplants longer than anyone anywhere.
This is 1326.
It's all apparently casual. It's like a well-rehearsed play. People are very friendly.
so that nobody gets nervous or upset. Nobody throws instruments anymore.
The transplant team's leader is Dr. Norman Shumway, who arrived at Stanford Medical Center 28 years ago. He came here from the University of Minnesota, where he witnessed the first open-heart surgery and decided he had a calling. But to do what he wanted, he needed freedom.
The great thing about Stanford was that if you could think of it, you could do it. There weren't all these traditions and restrictions that I think delayed the emergence, say, of heart transplantation in the East.
Shumway and his team at Stanford wanted to perform the first human heart transplant, but they had a problem finding donors who were legally dead under California state law and whose hearts were still in transplantable condition. While the state legislature hemmed and hawed, the world's attention focused on this man, a South African surgeon named Christian Barnard, who had beaten everyone to the punch. On December 3rd, 1967, he announced that he had performed the first human heart transplant. The accomplishment captured the public's imagination in a way that few things do. One person's heart beating in another's body. Shumway was left reeling.
Well, we of course fully expected that we would do it first, but it really doesn't matter. They use the same methods that were developed by us in the laboratories. So actually they were just following a project that we'd been working on for a long time. But it was interesting in that Barnard learned the surgical method from Richard Lauer, who was our first resident here. He was supposed to be learning how to do kidney transplants, but he went to the laboratory and saw Lauer doing these hearts, and he said, oh, this is much more interesting. I believe I'll do something like this.
Only 1 month later, Stanford administrators announced that Shumway had performed his first human heart transplant. Surgeons all over the world jumped on the bandwagon. Soon there were transplant recipients everywhere, all of them, it seemed, dying. Shumway's team was one of the few to continue doing research in the face of overwhelmingly dismal odds. Eventually, they began to get results. Today at Stanford, almost 80% of heart transplant patients survive the first year. And Shumway has gone on to even greater challenges, heart-lung transplants, and the use of mechanical heart assist devices. He works on the frontiers of science, and at Stanford, he isn't alone. Take a second and think about what it would mean if you could find a single technique that could be used to cure practically all diseases. Now that would be a miracle. That's what Dr. Paul Berg and his colleagues in the biochemistry department have been trying to do for almost 20 years. Far from the public eye, they've been trying to find the keys to who we are and what we're made of in our genes.
Everything we are as human beings is dictated by our genes. If you believe, as many of us do, that virtually all human disease is genetic in origin, then the more we understand about how genes function, the better able we would be to understand the mechanisms of disease.
In 1980, Paul Berg and his colleagues at Stanford won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry for developing a way of recombining DNA, splicing genes together. That technique is now used to produce hundreds of useful, even life-saving products, and is the basis for a whole new industry that may someday rival the electronics revolution. And Paul Berg sees that as only the beginning.
Taking a little bit of DNA from any individual, you could essentially establish a fingerprint of their genetic makeup. You might even imagine that it could all be encoded on a small credit card-sized card in magnetic symbols. The genetic fingerprint would carry with it certain predictions about what that person's future might entail.
Imagine knowing what the future held for you, knowing how long you would live, what disease you would probably die of. Could any of us handle that kind of omniscience? Paul Berg is a pioneer in uncharted territory, and with each new discovery he makes, there are risks. With the good news comes bad. That is the unfailing law of science.
Engine's throttling up, 3 inches now at 104%.
Challenger, go with throttle up.
Challenger, go with throttle up.
Astronaut Sally Ride watched in horror along with the rest of us as that was brutally demonstrated in the final flight of the Space Shuttle Challenger. Sally Ride has 3 degrees in physics from Stanford. She could have spent her life in a lab somewhere, monitoring radio signals from outer space. But instead, she became the first American woman to go into space.
Okay, I activated it at 2 days, 20 hours, 43 minutes, and it was reading zero, essentially.
As a mission specialist on the Challenger, she conducted her experiments high above the atmosphere.
There she goes.
That's a shift over to the Delta camera, and you can see the Ku band antenna there very briefly.
Okay, we got that now.
She describes the most thrilling moment of her life.
And liftoff of STS-7 and America's first woman astronaut. And the shuttle has pulled the tower.
It's a unique experience, partly because you realize that that all of a sudden the things that you've been training for specifically for the last year and generally for the last several years, are just about to happen, and they've closed the hatch and there's not a lot you can do about it, so if you change your mind, you're in trouble. And that culminated with just the feeling of power and the vibration and the noise and the excitement.
And the danger. 3 years later, this cockpit would be a ball of fire. Few scientists risk so much for the glory of discovery, but Sid Drell, one of Sally's professors at Stanford, thinks he understands what makes it all worthwhile. For himself, for Sally, for scientists everywhere.
This is the most exciting adventure of the human mind, this voyage of discovery. What are we made of? What holds us together? How did we evolve from the moment of creation? It's a never-ending quest, and it's, in a very fundamental way, many of us would say it's one of the great differences between us and the lesser forms of animals that crawl around in the forests.
Meet 2 billionaires, Bill Hewlett and David Packard, 2 of the founding fathers of Silicon Valley. They met each other in the 1930s when they were both sophomores at Stanford. Bill Hewlett remembers those times like they were only yesterday.
And I wasn't a stellar student. I, like a lot of engineers, I was interested in things that I was interested in and not interested in things I wasn't interested in. I took German and got a D plus and D and got the message.
Bring it on out, son. Yeah.
Those were the golden years of Stanford football, when both Hewlett and Packard found themselves warming the bench. That was when fullback Ernie Nevers, jersey number 1, was leading his team to a 22-5-1 record. That was when the legendary Stanford band first took to the field, when a guy named Doodles Weaver, who would later go on to perform with the Spike Jones band, became the campus clown. Those were the years the big game got really big, when the Stanford axe was stolen back, when the Stanford-Berkeley rivalry that had been mounting for decades finally hit its stride.
I'll tell you when the rivalry started, between 2 women, Mrs. Hurst and Mrs. Stanford, and they really competed with each other. Each one wanted to outdo the other. And in a sense, you can make the argument that this is one reason that both Stanford and Cal were so successful, because they were really competing with each other and trying to, if one did something, someone else had to do something better. But it goes back to these 2 women.
Yes, the Stanford story got its start in the 1800s, when Leland Stanford married Jane Lathrop and brought her to Rough and Ready, California. It took 10 years, but Leland certainly made his mark on the West. He became governor of California, then U.S. senator, and then went into the railroad business in a big way. Leland Stanford himself drove home the Golden Spike that completed the first transcontinental railway. For California, it meant the end of frontier days, as travel to and from the East quickly became commonplace. For the Stanfords, it meant a life of extraordinary wealth. They had beautiful homes. They had a priceless art collection. They traveled around the world. And in 1868, after 18 years of marriage, they got the one thing they thought they'd never have, a son, Leland Jr. The Stanfords purchased an 8,000-acre farm on the peninsula, where the young Leland would have plenty of room to grow. He was a serious-minded young man, one who built his own model train and collected ancient artifacts. And he was well-traveled. His parents made a point of taking him along on their trips abroad. It was on one such trip in 1884 that young Leland came down with typhoid fever and died. The Stanford line could have ended there. But the Stanfords decided they would instead make, as Leland put it, all the children of California their children. They decided to build a university, a great university, open to everyone, a living memorial to Leland Jr. Three years later, the cornerstone of Leland Stanford Jr. University was laid on the site of the Stanfords' Palo Alto farm. The Stanfords had decided against the stuffy kind of education they'd seen while visiting Ivy League schools in the East. Instead, said Stanford, they wanted to produce young men and women who could cope with the practicalities of life in the West. A half century later, that theory had been put into practice, nowhere better than in the classrooms of Frederick Terman, who taught Bill Hewlett and David Packard electrical engineering.
He had a feeling that anyone who took his course ought to be able to go in business. So he was the person who kind of talked us into the fact that maybe we ought to try going in business together. But that was 1934, and it wasn't a very good time to start out in business.
Silicon Valley started with Frederick Terman. What he did for Hewlett and Packard, he did for dozens of other students. Terman was no stranger to Stanford when he began teaching there in the early 30s. He had grown up right on campus. His father was Lewis Terman, a Stanford psychology professor who is best known for his development of the Stanford-Binet intelligence quotient, known to all of us today as IQ. Frederick Terman wasn't going to let two bright young students like Hewlett and Packard slip through his fingers, even if it was the middle of the Depression. So he made it possible for them to start their own company in 1939. With the sale of an audio oscillator Hewlett had built in class. It was that audio device, marketed out of this garage in Palo Alto, that made possible the lush sound of Walt Disney's Fantasia. $526 in their pockets, Hewlett and Packard were in business.
We did anything we could to bring in money. You know, we signed a foul line indicator for bowling, a shocking machine to make people lose weight, clock drive for a telescope, anything like that that would bring in some money.
Meanwhile, at labs in Stanford and around the country, the groundwork was being laid for a whole new industry. In 1956, William Shockley, then teaching at Stanford, won the Nobel Prize as co-inventor of the transistor, a predecessor of the silicon chip. Shockley and his proteges at Stanford turned that invention into a gold mine, spawning dozens of companies, giving birth to the computer industry. And it was Frederick Terman who kept the computer and other high-tech industries close to Stanford. Stanford Industrial Park, a complex that would one day become the heart of Silicon Valley. And all of it happening here, where 50 years before there were empty meadows.
I used to go and fly kites with my kids up in this hill here. You know, wind came over the hill like that. It was just a big field out here. As a matter of fact, I remember coming down when I was in college, coming down this hill and trying to see how fast I could get my car to go.
Jane and Leland Stanford never went to college. So when they sat down to decide who should attend their university, they had some curious ideas. They wanted two things. Stanford would be open to everyone, regardless of background. And there would be no tuition. Well, some things do change. Oh, and there was just one other thing. The last thing Jane Stanford wanted was to remember her son with a girls' school. So she set a limit on the number of women who could be admitted to Stanford. 500, she said, was more than enough. By the 1940s, when young Sandra Day was trying to get into Stanford, that quota had long been a thing of the past. Lucky for her, Sandra Day had wanted to go to only one school all her life. It was the school her rancher father hadn't been able to attend himself.
I started Stanford when I was quite young, actually. I was 16 when I entered Stanford. And I came from a public school background in El Paso, Texas. As a matter of fact, my high school neglected to tell me when the college entrance exams were being given. And the only university I ever wanted to attend was Stanford. And I was heartbroken to discover that I'd missed the entrance exam. Stanford admitted me provisionally with the understanding that I would take the examination later. And that's what happened. When I arrived, it was really a new world to me. I was terrified, I think, the first quarter. I had to decide what courses to study, what friends I should make, how I should conduct my personal relations, all the things that one learns as one grows up. And these things happen very quickly when you go off to a university or a college.
Sandra Day went straight to the top of her class, first as an economics major, then as a law student. She shared the limelight with another promising student, William Rehnquist, who she remembers driving a Studebaker held together with chewing gum. Along with the rest of her classmates, Sandra Day O'Connor hit the pavement shortly after graduation in search of her first job with a law firm. Unlike her male classmates, the best she could do was a position as a legal secretary. So much for being at the top of the class. It would take 30 years, but Sandra Day O'Connor would finally show the world the stuff she was made of when in 1981 she was appointed to the United States Supreme Court. Mrs. Stanford, for all her quotas, would have approved. She might look rich and spoiled, but Mrs. Stanford was as iron-willed as they come. Her husband died shortly after Stanford University opened, and it was up to Jane to keep it going. No easy matter, because Leland's estate was tied up in probate for 6 years. During that time, Mrs. Stanford was forced to sell many of her jewels just to keep the university going. At one point, she had to declare the faculty her personal servants so that she could pay them out of her household allowance. She died in 1905, a happy woman. The campus had grown and prospered under her guidance. She was spared the sight of the devastation that would soon follow. It took 7 years to rebuild after the 1906 earthquake, but Stanford University would survive that and much more. Financial troubles, two world wars, the Depression, survive it all and grow tenfold. Jane wouldn't have recognized the Stanford of the 1950s. The good times were rolling, and Stanford students were enjoying them along with everyone else. was the heyday of the Greek system, when girls like Diane Goldman, known to all of us today as Diane Feinstein, were elected house queen. Those were the years when students like Yale leader Bill Kartosian could run for every student body elected office, including women's crew captain, and win. The 50s were the years when adventurous students found their way to San Francisco's North Beach, where Allen Ginsberg and Lawrence Ferlinghetti were hanging out. One student making the pilgrimage north was an economics major named Dave Gard. But Dave wasn't satisfied with his spot in the audience. He got two fellow students to join him in what he hoped would be a profitable enterprise.
I remember Grandpa telling me that I was born as the sun was coming up early in the morning.
The group called themselves the Kingston Trio, and their goal was to make $500,000 each and then retire. On the way, they would popularize a whole new genre of protest music.
Early in the morning. It was early in the day when I set up to roam.
The Kingston Trio was organized on a business level. The three guys in the group were business-oriented people, so we were learning our music and our business at the same time. I actually went to the business school after I graduated for a little while, but it turned out that it was just a way of, you know, getting the band together during that time. Stanford's so nutritious and benevolent that they let you find your own way, I think, is what I liked about it, you know, in that respect. They didn't push you into any mold whatsoever. They assumed that you were already okay by the time you got started and just want to let your destiny unfold, as it were, you know. The Stanford students got us into the Purple Onion. They wanted just somebody to fill in for a week, so we sent postcards to all our pals around the Bay Area, in particular, many, many, many Stanford kids. So we packed out that week, and they all hooted and hollered when we came on stage. So then, a few months later, they started us off as the headliners at the club on the basis of this fantastic showing that we'd made. Later, we played to three and four people at a time, you know.
Dave Gard might not be a typical example of a Stanford Business School success story. Even in those days, the Biz School was world-renowned for turning out people like Sam Armacost, who would one day be president of Bank of America, and construction mogul Stephen Bechtel. Nope, Dave Gard wasn't your typical Stanford student entrepreneur. Or was he?
I was on the football team at Menlo School, which is very near Stanford. We therefore got to be ushers at the big game. So I went to the 1951 big game. And then Stanford went to the Rose Bowl. Right? That was a really terrific team. They lost that game. But I was ushering on the University of California side. That's just where they assigned me. They were foreign students there wearing steel gray matching top and bottom bus driver looking uniforms with slide rules on their hips. And I thought, very interesting. I'm just going to see what's going on with the Stanford side over at halftime. I moved over there. Here in 75 degree weather were ladies with blonde hair wearing fur coats sweltering away. I thought, I want to go to Stanford.
Dave Gard wasn't the only potential student swayed by the allure of Stanford football. At least one other young man thought what he saw on the field was reason enough to go to Stanford.
When I was in fifth grade, we took a field trip, and we saw Stanford play Oregon State and just get their butt kicked. And that kind of stuck in my mind over all those years. And then in 1962, I saw the Rose Bowl with Wisconsin and SC, and it was a heck of a game. It was one of the most exciting games I'd ever seen in my life. And all of a sudden, I wanted to play in that particular bowl game, in that particular bowl, and I wanted to attend Stanford and help them get there and help them win.
Jim Plunkett did just that, but not without a struggle. He was the son of two blind parents who had trouble enough just making ends meet. His problems didn't end when he got into Stanford.
I played very little as a freshman, got redshirted as a sophomore. So I hadn't had much playing time. I was thoroughly depressed, and I wanted to get out of Stanford. especially when they said they were going to move me from quarterback to a defensive end position. Heck, no way. You know, either give me another chance or I'm leaving.
In 1971, Jim Plunkett got another chance. Not only did he take the Stanford Indians to the Rose Bowl, he helped them win the game. The first Rose Bowl victory for Stanford since 1941. That year, he became the first and only Stanford player to take home the Heisman Trophy. The future had never looked better for Jim, but things were never to come easy for him. After 10 losing years, he finally got his chance to shine, taking the Oakland Raiders all the way to the Super Bowl.
Plunkett on a straight drop back. Here comes the rush. Steps up. Can't find anybody yet. Takes off running to the left. Rolls on the move. And it's caught by King at the 40. King takes over the 50. He'll go all the way. Nobody knows. To the 20, to the 10, to the 4. Touchdown Raiders. The Oakland Raiders are the champions of Super Bowl 15.
Today at 39, Jim Plunkett is still playing for the Raiders. He's the oldest player in the NFL. His name is a household word, and he and his family will never need to worry about stretching a dollar. But 20 years ago, when Jim Plunkett was attending Stanford, the security he now has was a distant dream. At the time, Jim Plunkett was one of only a handful of Mexican-American students at Stanford.
Suppose that the AB spreading rate changes from 5...
For many of those students, indeed for many students here, regardless of color, getting into Stanford was and is more than one kid's triumph. It can be the realization of an entire family's dreams. It can mean beating the odds.
I wanted to not be in the same situation my family was. I didn't want to be a mechanic or pump gas or anything like that. I wanted to help my parents out, first and foremost. So I had to look for a school that was going to help me do that, and Stanford, of course, was one of them, and the one in the end.
Leland Stanford was a man who loved a good horse race. He even raised his own trotters, many of them champions on the farm in Palo Alto. On the matter of horse flesh, he considered himself an expert. As legend has it, in 1872, he went so far as to wager $25,000 that he was right about the way a horse ran. As the story goes, a local newspaper owner bet Stanford that a trotting horse always had one foot touching the ground. But Leland knew better than that, and he hired photographer Edward Mybridge to prove that at some point in a horse's stride, all four hooves were off the ground. Mybridge set up a gauntlet of 24 cameras through which he ran Stanford's thoroughbreds. Sure enough, Leland was right. At mid-stride, all four hooves of the horses were off the ground. He made his point, and in the process, helped Mybridge lay the foundations of motion picture photography. 80 years later, a bet of another kind was made, just a half mile from the old red barn where Stanford kept his breed mares. It was the 1950s, and the Cold War was at its chilliest. Sputnik had been launched, and the U.S. was scrambling to catch up with the Russians in space and on the ground. Federal research money was pouring into universities at a time when enrollments were higher than they had ever been. It was in this atmosphere that a group of Stanford physicists met at the home of this man, Professor P. Panofsky. Together, they made a wager that would dwarf Leland Stanford's. They were gambling with the university's most valuable resource, its land. They wanted to take 480 acres of prime hillside and build what they called a monster. Their goal was to find out if protons, electrons, and neutrons were really the building blocks of matter, or whether inside those particles, for example, inside protons, there were even smaller particles called quarks. To find out for sure whether those smaller bits existed, you needed a machine that could hurl subatomic bullets at a tiny target with incredible speed and accuracy. You needed a building 2 miles long that cost $114 million to build. And even then, you might not get your answer. It took 10 years, but in 1966, the monster roared to life. And the atom began revealing its secrets.
We observed that the inside of the proton wasn't like jelly, but was like jam with seeds. We were able to find the seeds. And we did that by being able to have such hard collisions that when the electron hit the proton, it would bounce back because it ran into a hard seed, just like the cue ball on a pool table when you have the break shot. And so we were able to see that there were these seeds in there, and these were direct evidence. This provided direct evidence for quarks, the things we now believe are the elementary particles which three at a time together make up a proton.
The smaller the particles and distances explored, the bigger and more powerful the monster had to be. Additional facilities were added onto the 2-mile-long linear accelerator in the 70s. One of them, designed by this man, Bert Richter, would prove to be the biggest bargain in physics. It would make possible a discovery that would bring Richter and his team the Nobel Prize, the discovery of the J-psi particle, one of the tiniest building blocks of matter, one of four quarks scientists have been able to identify. Today, thousands of scientists from all over the world come to Stanford to use the accelerator. There are still only two others like it in the Western world. Its makers have never stopped pushing to make SLAC bigger and even more powerful. Today, the same men who gambled so much on SLAC 30 years ago are lobbying to build a 52-mile-long accelerator that will cost in excess of $4.5 billion. The project has powerful opponents, but in the long run, Sid Drell thinks that the quest for knowledge will win out, in no small measure due to the backing of major universities like Stanford.
They were willing to gamble, not knowing what would come out, just being willing to bet that if you have a good idea and you get good people and you back them strongly, something good will happen. But that is the idea of learning and of a great university.
By the mid-1930s, Hitler and Mussolini were sending us messages loud and clear. But most of us weren't listening.
I haven't the slightest idea of European affairs.
Still, one Stanford student was, and he decided he had to do something about it. But in 1932, Alan Cranston was just a rich kid from Los Altos who was having trouble getting into Stanford.
I'd grown up in the shadow of Stanford. I went to Pomona first, frankly, because my grades in high school weren't good enough to get me into Stanford, and then I transferred as soon as I could.
Alan Cranston finally made it into Stanford and majored in English. After graduation, he got a job as a foreign correspondent in Europe. What he saw there horrified him. Upset by America's indifference, Cranston decided he had to act. Out of his own pocket, Cranston and a friend translated Hitler's manifesto Mein Kampf into English and printed up 500,000 copies to warn Americans of the dangers of isolationism. Hitler sued young Cranston, trying to stop the publication, but it was too late. By then, 500,000 copies were already on the street. It was a daring act for a young man, but his deep concern had been brewing since his years at Stanford.
Well, we had long, long bull sessions on practically every topic you can think of. But a great deal of it would center around what was happening to the economy in the United States, why the Depression, were we going to work our way out of it, and what did that mean for our opportunities. And then we were looking at a world in turmoil with Hitler and Mussolini and the Japanese marauding. Those discussions had a lot to do with my own involvement in my life in efforts to create a more peaceful world.
Thirty years later, students again showed their passionate belief in their responsibilities as citizens. When most of us think back to those protest years, we remember Berkeley. Who could forget it?
Beatniks, radicals, and filthy speech advocates have brought shame on a great university.
Ronald Reagan has decided to associate himself with the free speech movement here at Berkeley.
And I'm here to try to dig it.
And we're gonna show them how hot it gets in these United States.
But Stanford had its own share of campus turmoil. On the surface, Stanford seemed, well, more polite about the whole thing. But like campuses everywhere at the time, Stanford had its values challenged, its population split by opposing furies.
We need to make a statement about the complicity of this university in the sorts of things that are going on in Southeast Asia.
A university basking in years of affection was suddenly under attack. And many at Stanford were appalled.
We're sick and tired of being pushed around by these so-called free speech people here. They're not for free speech whatsoever, they're for anarchy.
During these early years of protest, the student body president was David Harris, a former Fresno Boy of the Year, who says he took the lessons in his Western civilization class very seriously.
There was enormous intellectual interest in what are the responsibilities of a human being in a situation like Nazi Germany, which is to say that nobody is freed of their responsibilities as a human being simply because their government says they ought to do this, or that the policy of the nation is this, and we took those lessons quite seriously. Suddenly, as we began to notice that the war that was going on in Vietnam, and as that war began to escalate and we began to inform ourselves about it, it was obvious that the question facing us was not what do you do about the Germans, but what do you do if you're a German? Mm-hmm. And what do you do if you're inside that machine? And I felt a moral obligation about that.
To David Harris, the machine was Vietnam and the draft. And he became a national leader in the war resistance.
We are a peaceful demonstration. Everybody remember that. We are a peaceful demonstration.
To David Harris, having the courage of his convictions meant burning his draft card and going to federal prison for 2 years.
We're bound in jail.
While his wife, singer Joan Baez, kept the cause alive on the outside.
To go and pay their bail.
Talk's cheap from the left, it's cheap from the right, it's cheap from any political position. We weren't just talking, we were out there. I mean, we were prepared to sacrifice 5 years of our lives if it came to that, to try and stop this policy. And I think that affected people in ways that simply talk would not.
Don't you want somebody to love? Don't you need somebody to love?
The 60s. People were breaking the rules and breaking free. And the Bay Area was center stage for it all. And onto that stage strode an adventurer named Ken Kesey.
Kind of helping put it together.
As a creative writing fellow at Stanford in the mid-60s, Ken Kesey wrote his classic novel, One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. During those years, Kesey signed up as a subject in some experiments at Menlo Park's VA hospital. researchers paid him and dozens of other students $25 per experiment and gave them doses of a newly discovered drug, LSD.
Now, we never thought of it as drugs. We were doing something for the government. We were helping the government learn something about how to make people healthy and sane. And we were the cadre of psychedelic rangers and didn't even know it at the time. We were being trained, and then at a certain point, it's as though, I've always thought of it like this, it's saying, hey, we found this room over here, and we want some of you students to go over there and go down in that room and tell us what it's like. We came back out of that room, and they said, hey, don't let those students back in that room.
Kesey went back into that room again and again, and he took with him a band of Stanford students and faculty who called themselves the Merry Pranksters. They were a traveling circus with no real destination other than going further than anyone ever had. They wanted to shake people up and see what broke free.
You can build up a kind of a tartar of lies over your mind until there's nothing short of going to a dentist and have all that stuff scraped off. All of the action that was going on during the 60s, all the good action was based on this.
The 80s see a strangely sober Ken Kesey. He's settled down on his ranch in Oregon, and the only time he sees life on the road is on book tours. But when you look closely, you can still see the spark that set so many afire in the 60s. Kesey says Stanford's never been quite sure where to place him in their history.
They never could tell for sure if I was a feather in their cap or a black eye. I don't think they figured it out yet either.
He claimed to be the very first Stanford student, having camped out in Encina Hall before classes even began in the fall of 1891. He was orphaned before the age of 9, and his parents left him about $800. That was all he needed to get his start. He opened a laundry business on campus and always had a scheme up his sleeve to earn a little extra cash. Herbert Hoover, even at that young age, was a go-getter. He was also an avid geologist who parlayed his degree at Stanford into a successful career overseas, first as a mining engineer, then organizing relief efforts following World War I. After his world travels, Hoover settled down to a home he built on the Stanford campus. And it was there, in 1928, that John Philip Sousa and his band serenaded Hoover on the night he was elected U.S. president. Over his years of traveling, Hoover collected reams and reams of archival materials, everything from a first edition copy of the Communist Manifesto to the diary of Nazi leader Heinrich Himmler. He decided to build a library to house his collection, a tower on the Stanford campus. For miles around, you can see it, tall, tranquil. In many minds, Hoover Tower has become the symbol of Stanford. But in fact, it's at the center of a raging controversy over the roles and responsibilities of a university. There are some on campus who would say that the most important purpose of a university like Stanford in times like today is to provide a forum for the open exchange of ideas. Sometimes that means the expression of unpopular ideas, like those of William Shockley, co-inventor of the transistor, who in the late 70s announced his belief that some races were genetically inferior to others. On the same campus where you'll find Shockley, you'll also find English professor Ron Rebels, a vocal supporter of a movement to divest the university of investments in companies that do business in South Africa. On the same campus where you'll find students handing out Marxist literature, you'll find the Hoover Institute, which has over the years become a conservative think tank with strong ties to the Reagan administration. At Stanford, you'll find professors and students taking a stand on every conceivable issue, not just on campus, but on the global stage. People like physicist Sid Drell, who's been actively campaigning for arms control for more than 20 years. And professors like chemist Carl Gerassi, inventor of the birth control pill, who's the founder of Zero Population Growth and an outspoken critic of the U.S. government's position on birth control. State a position, and somewhere on campus you can find someone who disagrees with you. What everyone can agree on is that a university should be a place where scholars can study the lessons of history.
The great man theory of history, I think, just doesn't hold a lot of water, because there's always people who have a lot of charisma around it. Go into Black Baptist churches and you'll find a great deal of charisma, people who can speak as well as Martin Luther King.
The work being done by this man, Professor Claiborne Carson, is a good example. In 1986, Scoretta King presented him with the papers of her late husband, Martin Luther King, one of the most important collections in the history of the civil rights movement. At Stanford, Carson will have the time and the space and the support to preserve and study this irreplaceable bit of our history.
We'll be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual, free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
The elevation of the top of the Prisma and the elevation of the top of the Marine Terraces.
And finally, when it comes to what a university is, there's the obvious, what it does for students. In a word, educating them. Of course, not everyone who comes through Stanford goes on to become a best-selling author or a Supreme Court justice. Most of the thousands who graduate from here don't end up making the headlines. But in their own way, in their own worlds, they do make a difference. Go anywhere, to the ends of the earth, and you'll find them. Highlands of central Java. 3 bone-crunching hours from the nearest city. Russ Diltz, class of 74, is on his way to work. Russ grew up in Augusta, Georgia, never really thinking about what he'd be when he grew up. And then he got into Stanford, and the doors started opening that would lead to Indonesia. Now at 33, he's lived all over the world. But he remembers his first trip to Stanford as being as traumatic as any movie's ever made.
It's at least as much of a cultural shock to go from Georgia to Palo Alto, California. And maybe a worse shock in that it is the States, people speak the same languages, and things are very, very different.
Population of the village,
huh? I didn't know what a preppy was before I went to Stanford. That was quite interesting. I had always thought of myself as being a pretty middle-class kid, and suddenly there was picked up as being working-class hero. I had worked on truck docks, and I had union cards and other things, which was pretty normal for the South. It was not too normal for the Stanford community.
As far away as Stanford might have seemed from Augusta, Georgia, Russ still had a long ways to go. He changed his major from engineering to political science. He went to Europe and to Alaska, and finally he joined a program sponsored by Stanford called Volunteers in Asia, which brought him to Indonesia in 1974. When Russ first arrived in Indonesia, he lived in a remote village where he was one of only a handful of Westerners. His first job was teaching English to a class of 300 Indonesians. As foreign as it all may have seemed back then, today, 13 years later, he's made this place his home. Now, Russ spends most of his time training village leaders to organize their own communities, bringing electricity and clean water and good education and opportunity into their homes.
They weren't given a chance. They were often convinced by outsiders that they were dumb, that they needed help, and that they should be thankful for the help they got. The main point was that they planned it, they built the thing, they rejected outside assistance, they got only minor technical assistance, it's theirs.
Today, the village of Socorro-Guno is putting up six of these 900-pound piers, piers that will someday carry electrical wires into the village. The job will take 15 men and a half dozen bamboo poles. Russ isn't an engineer or an architect. What he has is something far more valuable than technical expertise. It's something that translates into any language, an infectious self-confidence that he can trace right back to his years at Stanford.
They provided for me opportunities. They encouraged me. They taught me how to use those opportunities. They let me go. It's the classic speech to the incoming class of the function of our university is to open your eyes to the world. And I guess they were serious, and I took them seriously. Here I am.
Oh, pretty. Happy birthday.
We've talked about some incredible accomplishments in the last hour. The splitting of the atom, the breaking of the DNA code, the pioneering of outer space. But none of those things is as extraordinary as what can happen in a single young mind. A mind open to new ideas, new ways of seeing the world, new ways of approaching old problems. To keep that spark of curiosity and inventiveness alive, young people need a place where it's safe to speak their mind, make mistakes, take risks. A place like Stanford. In a place like that, young people learn lessons that will guide them for the rest of their lives. So here's to Stanford for keeping so many minds young. I'm Jerry Graham. Good night.
Ready, set, go.